history is kind of taking a piece of it at a time and seeing how it all fits together. 150 years ago was Victorian time. It was the time right after the Civil War. When they come, sometimes they're a little leery about what is living history, but they find that we're trying out a little piece of history to see how it felt and how it was when people lived that time. It gives them a sense of where we've been and where we're going. About 25 years ago, Joanne Hunter and Dottie Freeman started looking at the Farm Museum and thinking that it would be a good idea to pass on some of the traditions of the farming community in Carroll County, and they decided it would be nice for the children to learn about that some more. So they started a summer living history camp for children in second, third, and fourth grades. About 17 years ago, I came on board as the coordinator for the camp, and have been here ever since doing that. I love the job. I grew up on a farm and feel that it's very important to pass some of the knowledge and information on to children as well. Clothes weren't as easy to come by. You got a piece of clothing, it meant that someone had sheared the sheep or had picked the cotton and had made the thread and had woven it and then had cut it out and sewn it and put it all together. And so that's a very important part in their lives.
We're introducing these kids to using a loom, learning how to weave. It was one of the most time-consuming jobs, is preparing fibers and weaving in any kind of an old farm, to the point that you would use even scraps of rags for making rugs. If it was better than a rug scrap, you would make quilts, you would make patches for clothing. To make a linen shirt, you'd have to start in the spring with planting flax, harvesting it in the winter, working through preparing the fiber for several months, then dyeing, and then weaving, and then cutting and sewing. So to make a young man a shirt, you're only going to take about a year and a half. Being able to process clothing is going to protect you in the winter time and keep you warm. It's once they sit down, it's like, I get it now. I see how this works. I'm sitting at the back end of the loom now, but suddenly it's, oh, fibers go up, fibers go down. When you put something in between and you change that up and down, it locks the fibers in place. That makes the material, and it's like, I see it now.
We weaved on a loom. Thought it was going to be kind of hard, but it's actually kind of easy.
It was just fun to weave and see the thing that I made.
The ladies in the heirloom garden tell them about growing gardens and that kind of thing 150 years ago.
My name is Kay Sedlak. I'm a member of the Carroll County Master Gardeners, and we are the caretakers of the heirloom garden here at the Farm Museum. We have a discussion about the parts of the plant that you would eat, a little bit about how we would save the seeds to pass down through the generations. Then they come to the garden and see the garden, and we explain some of the plants that they see here. This is part of their heritage that they probably aren't aware of because they're so used to food coming from the supermarket. And so we teach them that the settlers that came here didn't have food here to eat, so they brought their plants and their seeds with them. And one of the first things they would do when they arrived was to plant the garden because they needed that food for their survival. And then we try to show them the variety of plants And then they look at all the different types of plants. We have a number of herbs. They really enjoy the herbs that they can touch and smell.
And sometimes when you had a cold, they would make it real strong and make it so they'd put it on your chest in time so that you could breathe better. Does that smell a little bit different?
Yeah. And they return to their tables and have a flower pot that they fill. Plant a plant, and then they decorate it with paints to take home.
We just made a little herb garden, and we got to paint the pot, and we're gonna get to see them grow. And we went in the heirloom garden. We got to smell some mints and a bunch of different other plants. You couldn't just go to the grocery store. You had to grow all your stuff and wait for it to be at that exact time. Like if I wanted watermelon in winter, I couldn't get watermelon in winter. I would have to wait till summer to pick it.
They seem to enjoy it very much. One year we had a camper came through the garden later on at an event, and he told us that he had taken his plant home and nurtured it and entered it in the 4-H fair and got a blue ribbon. So you're always happy to hear that there's been follow through on what they've learned here.
We have a Civil War veteran that comes and talks to them about the things that he had during the war and what it was like to come back home after the war.
My name is Rick Barber. Me and my wife's been reenacting for 25 years, but doing this class from Ms. Witiak in the Farm Museum for a lot of years. Very informative to the kids. They're trying to learn the ways from the 1860s, washing clothes, making stuff, how you would dress. This gives the aspect of the Civil War.
This is my blanket. Whether it's 90 degrees or 20 degrees, this is all I have.
And things were much harder back then. There was a lot more disease, and a lot more people died from disease and things. And social status, the women weren't allowed to do so many things compared to nowadays.
She wouldn't carry money. Men had control of the money.
We'd like to be called living historians. We don't go out and just do cowboy games. It's planned battles of certain battles and places. We maneuver, we drill, we use Hardee's light infantry tactics, the same thing they used.
If I come back too far, I'm going to blow his eardrums out. If I go too far, I'm going to hurt him with the snap of the cap. Of course, after the first couple of battles, Abe was deaf anyway, so it really didn't matter.
He fired a gun.
Fire. Load.
It was real cool. And they showed us some of the clothes that they wore back then.
They're putting me on TV like this.
It's important for them to realize what the men and women, both North and South, went through during the conflict. The hardships the ladies had at home, how they dressed, how we dressed, what we ate, how we had to drill and fight. That was their war. It was not fought in another country, it was fought here. It was fought here right around the Farm Museum here in Westminster. I had three little girls this morning. I had last year. It's three different age groups. And the little girls come up and said, "We had you last year and we learned this, 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 and this." We're getting through to them. So it's pretty rewarding that they can remember from year to year.
Another thing is the wood project. One of the gentlemen that was a maintenance man here at the Farm Museum, and he designed three projects for us. So each year, one of those projects is for each one of the weeks, and we've been doing it for probably 15 years.
We're making tables for just tables for home.
Right now, the kids are making little tables, and when I was in camp, I made a table too, and they're really fun to make, and they're really easy to make too.
First, I had to sand the wood of every single piece, the four legs and the two, the bottom and the top, and then I had to stain it, and once I stain half of it, I have to wipe it to make it dry faster. It's really fun to do. And the standing is much easier than landing.
They learned the craftsmanship of how they made things back then because they couldn't just go and buy things. They had to make it by hand. They say that it's a really fun project and they really like it and they love the camp.
Either today or tomorrow, we're gonna actually connect it together. And then I think tomorrow we're supposed to take it home. It's gonna be a gift to my mom.
The volunteers here are wonderful, as they are all over Carroll County. The blacksmiths provide a project for them each time they come. They talk about how the blacksmith shop works and how important the blacksmith was to farm families. It's one of the things that the children love because they don't do that anywhere else.
Albin Dresnowski. I'm a volunteer here at the Carroll County Farm Museum. The Blacksmith Guild of Central Maryland, in return for allowing us to have our club here, we provide demonstrators here in the historic forge. Today the kids were taking a hook and putting a twist in it so that when it was done it would be an S hook. And they were doing that hot. The steel was hot when they twisted it.
I saw all these different tools. I wasn't quite sure what they were, but they looked cool. And I got to make this. It was cool kind of making it. First, he put it in the fire, and then I had to twist it to make this little twist. And then he did the rest. He put beeswax on it so it wouldn't rust. And then he dipped it in the water and it was finished.
Some of them are a little scared to be that close to hot steel. The steel that they're twisting is 1900 degrees. It gives them a chance to see how things were done before the current machine age, you could make things out of metal by hand. And today's machine shops, today's factories evolved out of the blacksmith shop. So it's a chance to see the evolution of metalworking from being a hand trade to a machine trade.
Another thing is dipping candles. You don't get to dip candles everywhere, and sometimes they're skinny and sometimes they're fat, but most of the time they turn out pretty good, and it's fun to do.
Valerie Dunn. I'm a group leader. We're dipping candles to see all the work that went into it, and then also because it's a lot of fun for the kids to see the progress of the candles, because the dipping doesn't just occur quickly. It takes a few dips. Candle dipping was very important because they wouldn't have electricity, so candles would light their houses. They'll start with a length of string about this long, and that will serve as their wick. And then we fold it in half, and they go up to the pot of wax, and they dip it in very quickly, and then wipe it on the side of the pot so they're not dripping wax everywhere. Then they go over to a cooling tub of water, they dip it in there, and then they run their fingers down the length of wax so that they have a nice straight candle. And they keep doing that, and to get it about this width, I'd say this is probably 10 or 15 dips. It depends on the heat of the wax.
Well, right now we're making candles. I'm having lots of fun. I actually like the painting of the candlesticks because you got to be creative.
It's pretty cool going. I mean, we already made the candle holders, now we're just getting the dips done.
Fishing is one of the highlights also. We go over to the community pond. We use some bamboo poles. The children catch and release the fish in one of the sessions, and they really enjoy that a lot.
My name is Vernal Wright, and my job position is volunteer fishing coordinator for the day. Basically, we're doing cane pole fishing. We provide the cane poles and the worms, and the kids get to try to catch and release fish. Even for the kids that have fished before, a lot of them haven't done cane fishing. And this is all part of a living history camp, and in the time frame that is involved here, cane fishing was actually the way most of the fishing was done. There was no rods and reels as such. And so it gives them an idea of a different way of fishing. And in a lot of cases, it's the only fishing that the kids have done. Basically, and they can actually be made out of anything, but the most common material today is bamboo poles and string or twine or fishing line. Cork bobber, or some of the poles have regular bobbers, a hook, and bait. And basically all you do is grab the end of the pole and lob it out and wait for the fish to bite. The ones who catch fish are very excited. You get the usual, "Oh, the worms are gross." But most of them are very pleased with the activity. The most common complaint is that it's too short. It's interesting to see the kids that haven't done it before and see their reactions when they catch a fish. And in some cases, you have to console the ones who don't catch fish and kind of help remind them that even the best fishermen have days when they don't catch fish, so you kind of have to help keep their spirits up. But overall, it's a lot of fun watching the kids and how excited they get when they catch a fish, even though they know it's just a little fish that they can't keep. Although we did have one kid ask if he could take it home and put it in his aquarium.
I caught a fish a couple minutes ago, but then I accidentally got tangled with someone else. So usually we have a thing to put the string on, like to wind up. And right now you don't have one of those, so you just have to hold the hook and then back and forth and then throw it.
Anytime you learn about your roots, about where you live, and about the people that have come before you, I think you gain a better understanding of who you are and the area that you live in. A lot of the things that we talk about here are the same, that are transferable, but in Carroll County it's special because there are signers of the Declaration of Independence who are from here. The history of the almshouse that's here, that lets the children know that people cared about people 150 years ago. It gives them a sense of where we've been and where we're going. I would say 95%, maybe 98% of the evaluations that we get back from the camp say that it's the best camp they've been to, that their kids learned the most, that they brought the most nice projects home, that they enjoyed being with one another. Two of our group leaders have been with us for 11 years. They come back every year. One, the first time she was here for 2 days and she said, "Miss Marian, can I come back again next year?" The number of teenage helpers that we have come back is another thing that lets us know that we're doing something right, because they are anxious to come back. They want to come back and serve their community in this camp and be a part of the Farm Museum each summer.